So initially I joined the industry. I was just out of school and I was like out of academia and I wanted to use anthropology and marketing and all of that together. But I had no idea, right? I've not studied marketing, I've not studied business, I've studied anthropology, which most people don't even understand, and it's a very nerdy discipline. And when I came back to Bombay and I was like, okay, what do I do with this degree? Immediately people around me were like, oh, this sounds like market research might have space for you. And so I spent my initial years sort of going from market research to insight to understanding these spaces. And when I decided to start on my own, I knew that I wanted to call myself a cultural strategist because my work is completely informed by culture. But I could not actually find that even in the LinkedIn drop-down menu or as an existing name. So I just made it up. And I think it's been 2 years now, and I've seen a lot of cultural strategists, which is really cool because obviously a lot of people around the world are doing what I'm doing, but there's no name for it, right? We can't call ourselves pure anthropologists because people don't understand that there's any need for that in marketing or brand. And if we just call ourselves strategists, then people are like, well, business strategy, right? So kind of created this word and it's worked out well. People have is that this is about religion, tradition, regions, right? So they're like, oh, culture, Indian culture, or if they're a little bit more nuanced, they may say that, oh, regional cultures, that's where it caps off. So people imagine that culture is big things, you know, language, traditions, festivals, and they would, if they were savvy, they would pay attention at the point of perhaps packaging things like that, where they'll say, you know, this color means this, right? That's what culture is about. Unfortunately, that's where the understanding of culture drops off, even in our marketing courses. Like the most they'll tell you is that, oh, in some country this word could mean something else, or in India red means something, but somewhere else it means. That's very big things. Actually, as an anthropologist, my job is to tell people and make them realize how culture is everything. You know how fish cannot see water because it's literally around you, and everything you've experienced is because of culture, which is why you don't realize it. And a way to explain it is culture is simply people's way of life, right? And we think about it in this way of traditions, festivals, religion, because in the past it was very fixed. Cultural change was not something that happened on a daily basis or weekly, yearly basis, because you would need two things. Either you need a technological invasion, or you need invention, or you need an actual physical invader who brings in a new culture. So culture was always seen as a very static thing, right? This is the culture of this place. This is the culture of this community. But now, since you've had your industrial revolution, you've had post-World War, and you have technology enter mainstream, every day people have options of what to do with a certain technology. And I'm calling everything technology, from your information to your gadgets and all of that. What they actually do with that is what culture is. Everybody is making different uses of the same things. So 150 years ago, you could have said the culture of a certain place. Now you can't say it because there'll be so many subcultures, there'll be so many smaller nuances that you can't definitively say, oh, this is the culture. Now you'll have to go smaller. Now you'll have to say, okay, the culture in Bangalore among techies who work for certain kinds of companies. So when nuance comes in, that's where culture has a role to play. There's this third definition of culture, which is not at all known by people, but is really actually what we study often in anthropology, in organizational anthropology, which is really the culture inside businesses and the culture of business. And this is a bit complicated because what it really says is that whatever kind of line of work you're in, or whatever industry you work in, has its own culture that you don't realize. Now, I could give you an example, right? When you're in advertising, there is a certain culture, there are certain standards of living, there are certain references you are supposed to understand, there are certain hierarchies you are supposed to know. And that is exactly what culture is, right? The unsaid, the framework, but we don't really accept it as such. So one of the things, the reason I named many of my speeches as culture in the room is because the elephant in the room is because this is what we don't talk about. It's there, and we don't, you know, realize it's there. My last point is something that often is, I think it's such a broad thing that becomes very difficult to explain to people, but the way in which business is done anywhere in the world, right? The way in which business and marketing, even advertising to a certain extent, is taught, has a huge cultural problem because it's taught from the perspective of where products were manufactured and advertised, and your consumer was just going to fall for it, you know, because there was no competition, there was no availability of products. You're talking about a time where commodity was really selling and advertising was giving you the push. Right now, very few people are buying product. They're buying into brand. They're buying into purpose. They're buying into what they feel about a certain company. And this may seem like, oh, it's very exaggerated, but it's not, right? It's actually pretty much mainstream and here to stay, which is kind of what culture is about. What do people actually feel, think about a certain brand? It's not what we think about the people. So in that sense, culture tells you that your consumer is actually a stakeholder in your business. Like, they need to be 50% part of the conversation. They're not passively receiving what you're making. They are actively creating, they are co-creating, they're reusing, remixing. And the lag between what you produce and how people feel about it has gone away. Because earlier, maybe people would wait for a newspaper article or a book to say that this product is good, bad, etc. Now it's in real time, which means that they have the power, which means they should have stake. With technology industries, or you work with these really amazing companies that are coming out of nothing. One thing you see in common is that they put the user needs, the consumer needs, the audience needs first, and then they sort of plan their way out of there. Whereas the archaic system where we blame consumers for not getting it, or we blame them for not having been evolved yet, goes the other way. If you were culturally intelligent, you would already know this is what they want. This is two steps ahead. So here's where I can pitch. But if you're creating for yourself, for your team, for your satisfaction, it's completely off. Whatever you're making, whether it's content companies I work with or whether it's actually a product that's going to go into somebody's house, it's designed for people to use, right? Unless you're literally producing technology for robots, you need to know about people. And it's not the job of marketing to only know about humans and everybody else to say, okay, it's marketing. So there's two things I always advise. One is that actually the HR and the hiring level hire people that are diverse. And I don't mean this in a politically correct way. I actually mean with different strengths and backgrounds. One thing you see, especially in startups, is, right, we gravitate towards people who are like us. They have the same backgrounds. They may have complementary skills. They may have gone to the same schools. You know, we're very much like the same circle. And what we create is we create isolation because you don't know what's happening in the world outside. Everybody is sort of in the same strata of society, sort of has the same beliefs and aspirations. And we create a false echo chamber where we're just validating each other's worldview. Itself, you diversify. And the second thing is when I'm teaching students, I teach them cultivate curiosity, which is something we do weekly if you're doing a team, if you're leading a team. So you see a certain video, right? People are forwarding WhatsApp videos to each other, or an ad campaign, or a song, or just something ridiculous that everyone's talking about. So take that moment to make it a moment of analysis. Ask people, what did you take away from this? Why? Instead of making it like, oh God, today's generation is so stupid, or this is what sells nowadays. If you take it down, break it down, why is this appealing? Who is it appealing to? Have we thought about this person? Is this person our audience? So there are so many active measures you can take if you just sort of humble yourself and you take a step back and you say, okay, I'm trying to represent a lot of people. Unless you're not, unless you're a company that literally creates for the same person that you are. Actually, the thing is, when I'm saying diverse talents, I'm not saying get more of the sort of same skill, but from different fields. I'm saying, let's say you have only a 3-person team. Let them not be 3 people from the same city, with the same growing up experiences, with the same set of circumstances they've lived in their whole life. How would one optimize that? So, of course, one thing I want to add is that in the way that I mean subcultures, or we mean them in the liberal arts, is actually groups of people with certain interests. So you have rappers as a subculture, you have skate boys as a subculture. And of course, you also have regional cultures, like you're saying, right? If you go to the south or the north, completely different cultures, even though they might be right next to each other spatially. Like, I've been involved in a project where from district to district, there was a difference in what people did with their land and how they processed ownership. That's true in India, actually. This sort of stuff happens. Somewhere there are people that are passing on land only matrilineally. Somewhere there are people that don't sell land for certain. There's all of these issues. What you can do, I would say, is first of all to optimize your sample. This is more of a business thing, but don't go where you don't know is that sort of what I advise people, first of all. Like, if you know what that place is all about, stay there and test out before you have the money to expand. That's all I'll say. And a lot of people say, well, that stifles innovation. Then how can you try something new, etc., right? But my advice has always been to try it out risk-free in a smaller area where you can afford to test. From Adidas to Lego to any company you know that's really made a mark, a lot of them have invested heavily in anthropologists going out and studying people and looking at what do people want, how do they use my product, and how do I make it better. That's one thing. Another thing is fundamentally brand, right? The concept of brand is the closest to anthropology. It's not a marketing concept as much, because break it down, what is brand? Brand is belief. That's it. And who studies belief? Anthropologists. Because belief is not a real tangible thing. It's just ephemeral. I believe a certain brand is good. My belief might not change despite you making bad products again and again, making bad decisions again and again, because once I've invested in that brand, I'm already hooked in. Very much like religion, very much like a cult. Once I've invested in it, I believe in it. And it's really difficult to look at brands without the lens of actually culture, because a brand can only resonate in a culture if the culture feels something that the brand offers. Let's take India, right? Let's say before this whole data revolution we had in the last 5 years, we did not know what 90% plus of this country really wants. We did not know that they can actually buy products that we were only marketing to upper middle class. We didn't know anything, to be honest. And that was because, first of all, I've already said we have these isolated, you know, offices, and our society is quite isolated. Like, you don't, your maid comes every day, but you don't know her last name, you know. But that same maid's child right now is not going to stay a driver or an office boy because of technology. He's going to upskill. He's going to go to school. He's going to be a startup founder, an influencer, all kinds of things. To me, these are all like fascinating changes. But in the language of marketing and business, we call them disruptions. So I think this is what technology gives you, is the ability to get information. And why it's important in India is because our culture was literally organized around not being able to get information, right? Unless you're very highly educated, you live near a metro, and you are of a certain class and background, you literally could not find out the most basic things, like how do I apply to a certain college? How do I get a scholarship? There was no way to know any of those things. Now, because it's free for all, we're going to see massive amounts of what I call restructuring and not disruption, where this idea of where someone has come from isn't really important compared to what someone can become. Then we sort of make it the buzzword for the decade. And I think purpose is important because people are finding purpose in their own lives. You look at anything, you look at the apps we have on our phone, this whole shift towards mindfulness, this detox life, this questioning of should people even get married anymore, should we just adopt pets? There's all these kinds of restructurings going on in society everywhere. This is not just an India thing, right? We know millennial, Gen Z, worldwide are changing at a speed that we've not seen before, which we are calling disruption. But it's a re-questioning of the system, right? Do we have to buy things because they exist, or do we have to buy them because there's something I can do good for somebody, for the planet, for another laborer, or whatever? Like, the idea of consumption obviously has changed. It's not the 50s. You're not buying to survive. You're buying to actually make a statement. And that's why purpose comes in, because you're trying to find a purpose for yourself. You're trying to show it in your choices that I care about the planet. I care about politics. I mean, absolutely. And I feel like, you know, startups are actually the best equipped for this, because you are taking on something that very likely exists, maybe in an inferior version or a different version, right? And you're like, this is my version of so-and-so product. And if you have a story behind it, you have a differentiator behind it that takes it away from this idea of the big corporates making it. That's why people will want to buy from you. In fact, that's the only thing that's going to stop people from continuing to buy from you when the big guys notice that you're doing this product and start making it as well. Like, you have the advantage of making up your story, of getting people hooked onto the story. But all of this has to be real, right? It can't be like a made up thing that you're projecting a story and then the back end is like your culture is completely messed up. It has to all make sense. It has to come from you. So you can't invent a purpose that's so big. You have two very divided opinions. You have your millennial elite sort of earning higher metro crowds who want to buy from a bespoke company, who want to say that, you know, the packaging is reusable. Mm-hmm. All of the woke things that we are right now talking about, purpose, etc. And then you have the mass consumer who's actually like, I want to buy from a brand because that's safe. And again, I could talk for 2 hours, as I did recently, about how Indians think about a brand versus a business and why that's a big issue. But mm-hmm. yeah, if an Indian consumer considers something a brand, they consider it to be trustworthy. And that's not yet something they would link with a startup. They would say, oh, I'll rather go with a Tata or a Unilever because they are brands and I'm safe with them. It's again an appetite for risk that decides these things, not anything else. So that same mass consumer 5 years down the line, perhaps with much higher disposable income, is going to then look at these more bespoke products and say, okay, I can take a risk with that now. Because if that goes bad, I've not lost money. I'm just, it's okay. My lifestyle can afford it. Yeah, I mean, I think that events like this, and we're going to have so many events. I'm not saying it's going to be Corona, but it's going to be a lot of disruption where people actually realize what they want and what is extraneous. And that's the reason I've been talking about purpose, right? I mean, if you come down to it, the studies I've done in this past year, there are people like myself who are shopping addicts with our V3 Amazon hauls and our Mintras and our ASOS coming in, who in the lockdown just realized I don't need it, you know. And that's one example. There are people who actually decided there are other things I need. For example, I think, was it Udemy that had 100% growth in this time that we've had, where people are like, I need to learn something, I need to upskill. So when people turn inwards, right, and anything can cause that. It could be a climate calamity, it could be Corona. When people turn inwards and realize, okay, this is what I want, that's a reckoning moment for businesses and brands to go like, okay, are we making things people want, or are we just continuing to make what we make? And the products that are selling right now, right, and have been selling throughout this pandemic, are the products that people have real use for. It's not like people predicted that all consumption will stop. That's not true, right? People have still been shopping. There are certain brands that have made more money now than before the pandemic. So it literally points to use, to purpose, to actual resonance in people's lives, which I think is something you can't hide from after. Absolutely. I don't see any way out of it. I mean, you have brands that have gone completely problem-free for years that are suddenly facing these big cancel culture sort of situations. And again, I'll always bring it back to, you know, have a reading of what you're doing. If your format is television and you're showing something that's potentially divisive, choose another platform. It's not so difficult. It just takes a minute to step back and say, okay, this is potentially not going to appeal to a lot of people. And this is going to appeal to people on Instagram, but not on something else. And the thing is, it's so easy, right? It would save you hundreds in how many ever crores of PR and product recall to have the presence of mind while crafting or while creating marketing or product to say, okay, who is it for and who is it not for, and respect that. And how will you know who is it for, who is it not for, if you are a bit culturally in tune? You know, you run your opinions and your assumptions by diverse sets of people. It would have taken 5 people to tell you this is okay to people who are like this. This is not okay to people who are like that. And then you use your common sense and decide how to make your channel mix. But it takes, you have to take a step back, because this is not going anywhere. This is going to increase. Cancel culture is not going anywhere. And it's, in fact, India has just started to face it. It's been 5-6 years in America where brands have got cancelled over small things, but just starting in